Dogmatic certainty is what many people think is the core of religion, especially Christianity. But Keith Ward, who's one of the most eminent Christian theologians, philosophers, and scholars of religion, begs to differ. For him, the personal relationship with Jesus is the core. And like all personal relationships, they differ.
Everybody's relationship is going to be different from everybody else's. And so that's part of what revelation is. It's your encounter with God through Christ. And obviously, some of the things you see and say are going to be different from other people. So diversity is essential to Christianity.
Hello, I'm Rachel Kahn, and my guest today on The Spirit of Things here on RN and online is Professor Keith Ward. He makes everything seem so straightforward, and that's because he initially trained as a philosopher and taught logic at the University of Glasgow and at St. Andrews. Later, he was ordained as a priest in the Church of England and has held many posts, including as prestigious Regius Professor of Divinity at Oxford University, Dean of Trinity Hall at Cambridge University, and co-founding president of the World Congress of Faiths. He's written 35 books on religion, philosophy, ethics, and theology, and in particular has an abiding interest in religion and science. During a trip to the UK earlier in the year, I visited Keith Ward at his home in Oxfordshire for an interview that would traverse many of these interests within the context of Rethinking Christianity, which is the title of one of his books. Well, Keith Ward, it's lovely to be here in Cumnor, where you live, a beautiful little town. Tell me a bit about it.
Well, it's a small village, really, on the outskirts of Oxford. It used to be owned by Abingdon Abbey, which was one of the largest abbeys in England, but was totally destroyed at the Reformation, really. But it retains its character. A village, it's got a pond, two pubs and a church, and that makes a village.
You live across from a rather impressive church and cemetery.
Yes, it's a Norman church, and I'm a minister of the Church of England, so I help there. And it's a typical English village church, so people of all sorts of opinions come, Protestant, Catholic, and even non-Christian will come occasionally for big festivals, so it's quite nice.
Protestant and Catholic?
They come. It's a Protestant church. It's Church of England. But we do have Catholic families who come, because they like what goes on, I suppose.
Lovely. Well, I'm speaking to you because you have made such an enormous contribution to Christian thought and how Christians ought to think about things like science and other religions. You've written almost 35 books, or perhaps you have written 35 books. Yes, I think you probably have. And I want to talk to you about one that is not your latest, but I think states your position most persuasively about the essential nature of Christian faith. And it's your book called Rethinking Christianity. But surprisingly, that essential nature is not a fixed set of beliefs, but an essential malleability that lies at the heart of Christians thinking about God. Why do you regard that as an important message today?
Well, I think it's important because, first of all, it's true. Christianity has changed every, well, let's say three centuries, quite radically in some ways. And secondly, because most people don't realize that. They think that whatever they think Christianity is what it is, and it's always been like that. So it's important to get a sense of history and the way things do change, so they're going to have to go on changing. The most obvious example of that is that Christianity began as a Jewish sect, thinking that Jesus was the Messiah, and kept the Torah and kept Jewish law. But within a generation, it had actually given up keeping Torah and had seen Jesus as the savior of the whole world. So it wasn't a part of Judaism anymore, and they'd split up. Rather unfortunately, probably, but anyway, that's what happened. And that was an enormous change from a Torah-based community to one which actually celebrated not having any religious laws. So that was a change right in the first generation. And those changes have gone on happening continuously throughout history.
But people who would argue with you would say, well, there may be all those changes in history, but right here in the Bible we've got, you know, a clarity about what are the basic essential beliefs of Christianity. But you argue that looking at the New Testament itself, you're already faced with a variety of interpretations of who Jesus was and what he believed. Can you give me a couple of examples?
Well, the most obvious one is that the complete difference between the first three Gospels, Matthew, Mark and Luke, and the Gospel of John. They're clearly talking about the same person doing roughly the same sorts of things and dying and being believed to have appeared after death. So they're talking about the same person. But in the first three Gospels, called the Synoptic Gospels, they have Jesus speaking in parables, and it says in the text, in order that people might not understand what he really means, which is not what most people think, but that's what it says in the text. Very short, cryptic parables. He never says that he's the Son of God. When Peter says, you are the Messiah, the chosen one of God, Jesus says, don't tell anybody. So that's called the messianic secret. And, he calls himself the Son of Man, whatever that means, probably just means a human being. Well, when you get to the Gospel of John, it's, of course, it starts off with saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. So you're starting straight away with Jesus being the Son of God. And he actually, in John's Gospel, goes around saying, I am the resurrection, the life, before Abraham was, I am. He goes around saying he's the Messiah, completely different from the Synoptic Gospels. And he doesn't tell any parables. There are no parables. He doesn't talk about the kingdom of God even, whereas in the Synoptics he says his message is the kingdom has come upon you, but in John he doesn't say that. He speaks in very long speeches, but no parables. So this is a very different presentation of the person of Jesus. And I suppose rather crudely and generally, you could say the first three Gospels see Jesus as a spirit-inspired human being, although the status is a bit unclear. But in John, it's perfectly clear. He's the Son of God, and he's the Word of God, the eternal wisdom of God embodied in a human person. So same person, but totally different views of his status and his role and what he is.
So, in other words, are you saying that Christians should view the scriptures as basically different accounts of how the disciples saw Jesus, rather than to read the scripture as Jesus' own words?
Yes, I think that's true. Most biblical scholars would say that probably Jesus himself didn't say all the long speeches in John's Gospel, so they were put together by someone who believed that that's what Jesus was all about, but they aren't the actual words of Jesus. And I think that's very important to notice, that when you read the Gospels carefully and you set them alongside one another, the same incidents and the same things that Jesus says are rather differently put. I mean, they're actually in Greek, whereas Jesus almost certainly spoke Aramaic, so they're already translations. If you compare Matthew and Luke and John, for example, the same incidents, he says different specific things. So it's important to see that you don't have the actual words of Jesus. You have people's interpretations and memories of the words. Now, people like me think they're going to be, on the whole, accurate, but still they're different. So you're exactly right. I mean, what the New Testament, what the Gospels give you are the interpretations of the disciples of Jesus, rather than Jesus saying, this is what you're supposed to believe.
And that's pretty fundamentally different from, say, the way Muslims read the Quran.
It is. That's a very significant difference. I mean, Muslims would say that the Quran records the actual words of God, spoken probably by the Archangel Gabriel, but they are the words of God. And Muhammad simply repeated them. He recited them. He didn't make them up. So the Quran is all in one sort of Arabic. The style is all consistent. And these words, even if you don't know what they mean, they're often very mysterious indeed. But still, they are God's words, and that's it. In the New Testament, you've got Gospels and letters written by different people in very different styles of Greek, and actually saying rather different things sometimes, like on what day was the Last Supper? Well, John disagrees with the other three Gospels on which day it was. Was it the Passover or before the Passover? So you already have differences of style, differences of writing, even differences of particular accounts. And that's totally different from the Quran. So you can't really say, a Christian can't really say, of the New Testament, these are the words of God. You can say something a bit more subtle, like God was speaking through these words, but they're not God's actual dictated words. That is uncontroversially true.
And it's a truth, I guess, that many scholars over the years have revealed. But does that then nullify the idea that there is one true way of reading the scriptures and thereby, you know, really disarm those who say that they have the truth when it comes to Christianity?
Yes, I think such a view would be totally mistaken. And I don't see how anybody can say it if they realize there are other Christians in other churches who interpret these things differently. It's not only Catholic interpretations being different from Protestant, it's that Baptist interpretations are different from Methodist interpretations. And if you don't like one interpretation, you join your own church. And that's the way you do it. You know, Ian Paisley, for example, just made up his own church. Well, when you do that, it's a bit difficult to say yours is the only true view. I think a little bit of humility might not be out of place.
That probably came quite hard to Mr. Paisley, the late Ian Paisley. Well, then how do you understand the significance of the transcendent revelations that were experienced by Peter and Paul? Are they history or are they examples of perhaps how Christians might connect to or encounter God?
Well, I think Karl Barth, the Reformed theologian, probably one of the best-known theologians in the 20th century, put it rather well. He said the Word of God for Christians is the person of Jesus, and the Bible is a witness to the Word of God. So the Bible is a witness. There's lots of different witnesses, actually. And if you say that, you realize that when you're looking at a person and different people look at that person, you get lots of different views, lots of different ideas and disagreements about what they might have meant. And that's going to be true of the scriptures as well. You're going to have people looking at the person of Jesus. So what this means is the revelation of God in Christ is a revelation in a person. And if you say that, that can be very important if you think you possible to have a personal relationship with that person. But still, everybody's relationship is going to be different from everybody else's. And so that's part of what revelation is. It's your encounter with God through Christ. And obviously, some of the things you see and say are going to be different from other people. So diversity is essential to Christianity. It's absolutely essential that Christians say, mine is not the only true view. But I think it's a good one, of course, but it's not the only true one.
The Reverend Professor Keith Ward. If you're a bit rusty on Christianity, one of the best books you can read is Keith Ward's Christianity, A Short Introduction. This is The Spirit of Things on RN and online. Download the audio of this program to hear at your leisure. Keith Ward has been at the forefront of studying and living the Christian faith, which he argues is not primarily about doctrine. If reading the Bible as history is not the starting point of faith, neither, it seems, are church doctrines in your view. You say that Christian faith should not start with doctrines, but with a living encounter with the Spirit of Christ. Does this mean faith doesn't need complex theological, philosophical formulations to happen and to be true? And was that your experience?
Well, this is quite a difficult one, but I think in a sense, Christian faith needs complex philosophical doctrines, but only in order to argue against other complex philosophical doctrines, right? So that's a very arcane set of disputes. They have to go on. Ordinary Christian faith is meeting God in Jesus and in the testimonies to what he was like, what he did, and how he gave his life for the world, according to their interpretation. And that's what it's about. The early Christians, the first generation, didn't have complex doctrines. I mean, the idea of the Trinity is not mentioned, actually, in the New Testament anywhere. So that grew up, and it was about 400 AD before it was officially decided that the Holy Spirit actually was divine, really. So that's it's grown up and developed over the years. So doctrines are ways of trying to make faith in God on this particular path consistent with all our other knowledge. And all our other knowledge is changing all the time, so that there have to be these attempts made by just ordinary people like me, not by infallible mouthpieces of God, of trying to make sense of what we've received as the Christian faith in the light of knowledge of the world as science and history tell us it's like. So theology, you know, thinking about doctrines is important. But I suppose I'd say they've been reformulated in many ways anyway over the years. I mean, the Trinity is a very good example. If you say, according to 4th and 5th century thought, the Trinity is three persons in one substance, and people still use that formula. But it doesn't really make sense in modern English. Take my word for it.
Well, if there's some doubt or dispute about what those creeds and doctrines actually mean, then what should Christians believe about Jesus as an essential foundation of their faith? What is his significance to them on a day-to-day basis?
Right. Well, I think the most important thing about Jesus is that he reveals God as a God of unlimited love. That he died because of human sin, human wrongdoing, human failure, and he was believed to have risen from death as a sign that death is not the end and that there is an everlasting life with God. So I think those are the absolute fundamentals, that there is a God, there is a personal being of some sort who has created the universe. And the nature of that God is not, as too many people in the world think, somebody who wants you to go around killing other people in order to worship God in your way. That's the last thing God is. I mean, on the Christian view, God is self-giving love. The word is agape in the Greek, which means self-giving. You die to yourself in order to live for others. And God is like that. And I think it's the most important religious message in the world today, when you have people going around killing in the name of God. Certainly Christians have done this too, unfortunately, but it's totally opposed to the message of Jesus. So I think Jesus is very important as a person who shows that God is self-giving love. I think that's the central thing. So what Jesus did on a Friday, or whether he did it on a Thursday, or exactly what he said, is not so important. What is important, his life was lived as a witness to the self-giving love of God. And, you know, beyond that, I think you can use your own imagination quite a lot.
Well, one of the people who've used his imagination is Stephen Post. He often uses the term unlimited love, and I think he has an institute for the study of unlimited love. I've spoken to him about it. It's funded by the Templeton Foundation, and I was struck by you're using that term. Do you know the work of Stephen Post?
I do, yes. And I think that's right. It is a very important thing to say. If you want to say the most important thing about the Christian gospel, in my view, in the modern world, is that unlimited love has to be the key thing about religious faith. And if there's anybody that you hate, then you're not a Christian.
Well, love is one thing, but the thornier concept and demanding imperative is living a moral life. How do you conceive of Christian morality, and particularly when you categorically say that it's not a specific set of moral rules?
Right. I say that in the book, of course. I have in mind specific rules about whether abortion should be permitted or not. Now, you could have a religion which gave an answer to that. Not many religions actually do in their written texts. But you could have had. Jesus could have said, you know, by the way, abortion is forbidden. He didn't. If you look through the Gospels, you won't find any specific moral recommendations. Doesn't say you've got to be a socialist, you've got to aim at social equality. It doesn't say anything like that. It doesn't say what justice is. Yes, Jesus says, you've heard an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, but I say, you know, be be compassionate and merciful, but he doesn't tell you exactly what that means, and there are difficult moral dilemmas all the time, and you don't get a clue from the Gospels how to deal with them. People who think the Gospels do have a clear teaching haven't read them properly. Jesus never gives a straight answer to a moral question. Should I pay taxes to Caesar or not? Well, whose head is on the coin, you know? Give to God what is God's, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. And that leaves you in the dark because everything's God's after all. So what are you supposed to do? He doesn't answer the question. So that's what I mean, that Jesus doesn't have specific answers. Of course he says, love your neighbor, love God. But he doesn't say what that consists in. And that leaves you with all the hard moral problems. And I think that's where we are. I mean, that's just life. We've got to work these things out for ourselves. We could listen to the church or read the Bible and hope we'd get inspiration, but we make the decision.
Well, as you say, it seems like one has to keep rethinking Christianity. That's the task. But it's a task often identified with liberal Christianity, an adaptive approach to the faith. But you ground it in the words of the Hebrew prophet Amos, who says, I despise your festivals and take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Let justice roll down like rain and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Do you see liberal Christianity as an echo of this call to do away with pious tradition?
And the word liberal is really almost unusable in the modern world. I go to America quite a lot, and if I say liberal there, it means something totally different from anything I've ever dreamt of. In England, in my tradition, liberal means John Stuart Mill, and John Stuart Mill just taught humane sympathy and universal tolerance, and that's it. It's got no real other meaning than that, basically. And that's what I mean by liberal. Now, I think I'd say it would be an illiberal attitude if you said that certain words in the Bible had to be always interpreted in the same way throughout the generation, so it's never changed. Now, liberal view is open-minded. It's one of the basic meanings of liberal. So you're open to seeing how words just have changed their meaning over the years. The irony is, if you refuse to change the words, actually they'll mean something different than they used to mean when they were first used. So you have to change it even to keep them the same. I mean, just to take an example in English that I came across the other day, talking to some younger people, and they said this view was wicked. Now, I'd think that meant it was a very bad view, but actually I have to tell you that in modern England it means that's very good. So how this happens, I don't know, but you just have to see that words get their use within communities of people. Communities of people are always changing in the way they use things. Even the word religion, I mean, if you say, what does that mean? It means different things in different groups of people. That means you've got to realize that the words you use are going to reflect the society you live in. And since the words in the Bible, for example, are in Greek from a society we know almost nothing about 2,000 years ago in the Middle East, that's why we have so many different translations of the Bible. Because there really are just different ways of interpreting the words. Now, Protestants know that very well. They like their own translation, but can they honestly say with a straight face, and this translation is the only correct one? I don't think so. So that's what I mean by liberal. You're open, but the basic thing, Jesus shows God as self-giving love. That, yes, okay, right. Though even then, you see, even then, if you ask what self-giving love is, and you talk to some feminists, you might think that has its downside and gets people to think they ought to be going around serving all the men because it's good to be self-giving. And that's gone wrong. And you'd need to say in that context, well, that's not what self-giving means. It's the men who ought to be self-giving. You need to do something like that. So liberal is just an awareness that you can't use ancient phrases as though they meant the same thing all the time. Mm. The other important thing there is modern science, of course, has transformed our view of the world, a little planet we are now in billions of galaxies and billions of stars. So you just can't put things in the same way as when we thought the Earth was, as in Genesis, as a flat disk floating on water. I mean, it's just not an option. So it's liberal in the sense you try to see the faith in an expanded context. It doesn't mean anything goes.
Keith Ward's definition of liberal faith. He's the former Regius Professor of Divinity at Oxford, and he also delivered the prestigious Gifford Lectures at the University of Glasgow, where he once taught philosophical logic. You're with the Spirit of Things on RN, and as we get toward Christmas, we're hearing what one of the English-speaking world's most eminent theologians thinks about Christianity. Love is at the heart of the Christian message, and it's the theme of this now famous contemporary motet written by the composer Paul Millar for the royal wedding of William and Kate in 2011. It's based on a 6th century Christian prayer, Ubi Caritas, where there is love, sung here by the group Tenebrae. Ward, you've written extensively on other religions, notably in your book God, A Guide for the Perplexed, a title that echoes the famous treatise of the 12th century Jewish philosopher Moses Maimonides, or Moses ben Maimon. Is the God that exists for Jews, past and present, the same God that exists for Christians?
Absolutely. Yep. I'm in no doubt of that at all. When you say the same God, you might be meaning, does this God have exactly the same character? Is this God seen in exactly the same way? And then you'd say, well, no, but then among Christians, different Christians, God wouldn't be seen in exactly the same way. But if you mean, is there one supreme creator of the universe who is compassionate and merciful and just, Jews and Christians both say, yeah, absolutely. So do Muslims, actually. And so do most Hindus, strangely. Most people don't think that, but it's true. So I think there is a worldwide acceptance that there is a spiritual reality of wisdom and justice and compassion, and that is God. So I'm prepared to say the same God is worshipped all over the place under different descriptions.
Yes, I mean, when I encountered devotees who believe their guru, who passed away 50 years ago, was the perfect embodiment of love, perfection, kindness, etc. And they meditate daily to raise the God consciousness into awareness and into their lives and into relationships with other people and the community at large. Does this qualify as promoting union with divine spirit, capital S, and love?
I think it does. And one thing you can't say is that all religions are the same or they all believe the same things, because they clearly don't. I mean, there are differences of belief. But I think you can say that a great number of religions do worship a supreme spiritual reality who is merciful and just and compassionate. And that's an important basis of agreement. So I think that the feature I would pick out as most important is what you mean by the goodness of God. What would it be for God to be supremely good? And you can get differences there. And at that point, I think the person of Jesus is a very important witness to the nature of God. But I'm somebody who would say, if there is a God who is absolute love, you'd expect that God to make the divine being known to people in many different cultures and traditions. And that's a good Christian reason for saying that God isn't confined to Christianity.
Have you had any pushback on that by other Christians?
Not really. I think there are some Christians who wouldn't speak to me, probably. But the ones who do speak to me, I don't know why. Maybe it's because I'm a professor, so they think that's what you have to expect from professors, and they just leave me alone. No, I think a lot of, you know, I help in churches and preach sermons and things and talk to people, and I think the ordinary Christian, if you like, the ordinary Christian's views are much more open and liberal than their official representatives sometimes are, and they have no difficulty with saying, yeah, we all worship God, don't we? And Actually, all the best writers in religion say we don't know exactly what God is. And if you say that, how can you argue about it?
Well, indeed, I think you have said, and it's a very good formula for keeping your faith open to revision, which is simply the acknowledgement that absolute truth is beyond you, which is a very reasonable statement, and that you're obliged to understand more widely, more deeply, and never give up the search.
I think that's true. I would want to say there is such a thing as absolute truth. I mean, something is the case. But our chances of knowing exactly what that is are very small. I mean, I used to think there were some people who might know, but I've become a professor of theology, so I'm one of the people who ought to know. And I know that I don't know. So really, I think the chances that somebody else does are rather small. So yes, we've got to keep trying. There is a truth. You can't just say, oh, it doesn't matter what you believe. But philosophers use the expression, there is no such thing as a view from nowhere. You all stand in a particular place and you start from there and you develop by interacting with others as best as you can. So the search is important, but it's equally important to say, this is my perspective on the truth. There may be others which I need to learn about as well.
Well, one of the philosophers who tried to get at that truth was the German philosopher Friedrich Schleiermacher at the turn of the 19th century, who defined religion as a sense and taste for the infinite and an intuition of the whole mediated through a particular experience. If this is a universal experience, what makes it more than just a subjective feeling?
Well, Schleiermacher is a very much misunderstood theologian. He's often called the father of liberal Protestantism, as he is. But when he talks about feeling, this is often misunderstood. People think feeling is a subjective thing in you, and you know, different people have different feelings, doesn't matter. But by feeling, he meant apprehension. If you were, this is one of these words, you know, how do you translate the word? In German, it's definitely an apprehension, which Kant used as well. And so what that means is not just a feeling, it's an appropriate reaction to the reality of what you encounter. So there is something you encounter. Now, it's true that people encounter the spiritual in different particular ways, but there is something which they encounter, and there is an appropriate response to that. I think it's very important to see that knowledge of something, apprehension, is not purely neutral. It's not something without any affective or feeling tone to it. So when you encounter many things in your experience, you naturally feel aversion or pleasure or attraction, and that's part of your knowledge. Martin Buber is a great influence on many theologians like me, and he would say, well, meeting another person is a very personal thing. It involves your own nature. What you see in somebody else is a reflection of what you are, but still it's not purely subjective. It's the encounter of what you are with what they are, and that is an objective apprehension. So I think Schleiermacher was really, would be better in English, modern English, to say that it's not a feeling of the infinite, a subjective feeling, it's an apprehension of the infinite in and through the finite. And that stresses the objective more, but as in the case of truth, it says the way you approach the objective is naturally going to be influenced by what you are, the words you have, the language you speak, the background you have. But it's still an apprehension. And I think he was right.
And if this experience is a transformation, which one would hope that that meeting of God elicits a transformation in oneself, should that be the criterion by which you think a religious faith should be judged as authentic or real or living? And if it's absent, is it a time for rethinking the faith?
Yes, absolutely it is. I think that's the test. And of course, one of the original meanings of the word religion was actually piety. To be religious was to be pious, to be devout. That word too might have a negative ring for some people, but what I mean by it, by devoutness, is commitment to the highest moral ideals that you have, plus a personal reverence for that which is good, it being rooted in a spiritual reality which is personal. So it's a blend of moral commitment and devotional reverence, really. That's how you judge true religion, not by whether you've got all your doctrines right.
But it's difficult to keep up that experience or potential for the encounter? I mean, how does one keep up the discipline of maintaining that relationship to God in an alive way?
Well, that's probably not within our power to keep it alive, really. And I don't think that's particularly important. I mean, I think what's important is to have the inner total attitude that you are encountering the spiritual in everything that you encounter. And whether or not that produces great emotional vibes in you is not within your control. Sometimes it might. You're lucky if it does. But I think most of the great spiritually enlightened people have said that's not the point. So that's more an attitude of mind, a way of encountering things, than a great feeling of ecstasy. Yeah.
Part of the way you imagine and experience the religious life is that there's a lot of beauty and truth and goodness in it.
That's right. I've got a very positive view of religion. I don't like sermons about hell and judgment and damnation. I like sermons about heaven and God and eternal love. And why not? Let's be positive. Be too much negative religion in the world.
Yes, you say the temper of faith is self-deprecating and joyful, not cynical and destructive. So what has turned us into the latter? Why are we so inclined toward the destructive?
Well, we all like a good soap opera, don't we? And we find it more interesting to quarrel with people than to agree with them. It's just human nature. I mean, humans will really do something terrible to everything they touch. We call that sin. And I think that's what it is. I think religion would be perfect if there were no people in it.
Well, this possibility of participation in the spirit of love and joy and goodness that comes from beyond the self is somehow present in the self. That's how you describe a kind of everyday invitation to the experience of faith. Does that mean Christians can accept that theirs is but one avenue to the experience of the divine and God's encounter with humanity?
Yes, I don't see any trouble with that. I think most ordinary Christians would accept that. They're not going to. I think the Jewish attitude is one that Christians could imitate more. That is to say, we're not trying to make everybody believe what we believe, but this is something good and it's positive. And, you know, if you want to share some of it, you can. And I think Christians should say that. They should say this is a great way of life, a great way of encountering God. It's a challenging way of life and it's worthwhile. And leave it at that and say, well, that's the missionary work, is just to say, isn't this a great way of life? And if you find it appealing, then learn more about it. But not say, and by the way, if you don't do that, you'll go to hell forever, unfortunately. And no, I'm against that. So I think the appeal of any religion ought to be its goodness and its plausibility and its attractiveness, but not fear.
Keith Ward, Anglican priest and scholar of religion, is putting forth what he thinks ought to be the missionary stance of the Christian, an invitation to a life that is good and meaningful, but not an ultimatum. He's one of the most philosophically tempered writers on religion and Christianity. Well, attractiveness has sometimes been at the forefront of Christianity and other religions who try very hard to appeal to the generation that is before them, the younger generation. In Rethinking Christianity, you say the task is ongoing to rethink it and perhaps reform it. But can this be faulted as merely a capitulation to culture?
Well, I don't know why we should talk about a capitulation to culture, really, because most of the culture of countries like England or even Australia are founded on Christian past. And that's been changed because people have found things in Christianity they didn't like and are not very nice. Exclusiveness and hypocrisy and deceit and various things that occur. So those ought to be opposed. So I think culture is to be embraced because culture is a product of religious faith, amongst other things. It's not that religion is anti-cultural. We've been in a Christian culture for quite a long time. And if now people say we're in a post-Christian culture, well, maybe it's post a certain sort of Christianity, a negative, condemnatory, judgmental sort. and we can move to more like what it originally was, which is a way of life which offers hope and endeavor for the future. So we ought to take the best from culture, because culture has taken the best from Christianity.
Well, that's a wonderful formulation. Well, you've called yourself both liberal and orthodox, liberal in accepting that faith's outward husk can change, but orthodox in acknowledging a core belief that remains. How would you describe what that core is?
Well, I think most importantly, that there is a God, that there is a supreme spiritual source of reality. That's very important. And that the nature of that God is revealed in Jesus, interpreted as someone who reconciled, forgave, gave himself for the sake of God's kingdom, and who was believed, I think rightly, to have appeared after his physical death, to show that the love of God cannot be defeated by suffering and death. And also I'd add to that, that Christ is not simply a person who lived a long time ago, but through the Spirit of God can be known as a revitalizing force in personal life. And I think that would be enough. And then after that, you could just say, well, I've got the fundamentals. You know, I've never understood why people call fundamentalists believe so many non-fundamental things, like the virgin birth happened. I can't think of any great thing that would change in my life if it didn't happen, right? Whereas, if you said, and Jesus didn't rise from the dead, that he was defeated, he didn't live with God after that, I think that would be a change in my life. I'd say, oh dear, things aren't the way I thought they were. So that's a fundamental difference. It's got to change your life.
What do you think then about the progressive Christians, as they call themselves, who are not so fussed about the supernaturalist elements of the story of Jesus, but who adhere to him as a great moral teacher of self-giving love?
Right. Well, I very much sympathize with that, and I'd certainly be happy to embrace them within any church I was in. But I think a bit more is required. I think a moral failure is not the greatest person to imitate. He wasn't a failure morally. He was a moral person who, on that view, would have been a failure. You know, he just died and was defeated. So goodness gets defeated would be the message. Mm. I'd feel a bit unhappy about that. And I'd say it's very important, if there is a spiritual route to reality, that goodness will not be defeated. And I'd expect the life of Jesus to show that that was true. So the resurrection for me is important. It's not just a superstitious vision of some sort. It's the message that in the life of God, we all are transformed from defeat into victory. I've got a bit more, but I think they've got the important thing.
You've called yourself a born-again Christian.
Ah, that's true.
Was that an experience that was early on, or did it come to you later?
It came later, yeah. I was an adult. So for an academic to admit this is a bit embarrassing, but I did have what can only be described by me as
Gosh, Keith, why is that? I mean, after all, you are writing about the encounter with God, the transforming experience, the taste of that. And yet, as an academic, to admit a born-again experience is sort of off the map.
Yes.
Why?
Why? I suppose because of its connotations. But the people who use the expression born-again Christian often are people who take the Bible literally in one sense and think that most people are going to hell. And there's a whole lot of stuff that goes along with that, a lot of baggage. So that's why, really. And so it would be nice to use the expression born again without people thinking, oh yes, and he comes from Arkansas.
But haven't the evangelicals in the Anglican Church mutated, as it were?
They're mutating, yeah, they are. I think that's true, yes.
I hope that wasn't a bad choice of words. I mean, aren't they changing in a way? I mean, what is an evangelical these days? It could be, you know, quite a number of points along the spectrum.
Yeah, and I talk to 18-year-olds a lot in schools, and they don't know what an evangelical is or a Catholic is or what the difference is between them. They haven't got this. These old arguments have just become obsolete. So the old-fashioned evangelical who's all, you know, Pope is Antichrist and all sorts of stuff, nobody knows what on earth they're talking about. So things are changing a lot, and in many ways for the better. Well, the church is getting weaker. Perhaps that's for the better too, as an institution it's getting weaker. One of my favorite theologians, Karl Rahner, is a Jesuit Catholic theologian, he actually said, well, probably in the future bishops will be committees of women. And he said that. There's hope.
Right.
Right.
Well, for a true definition of Protestant faith, you quote the Danish philosopher Søren Kierkegaard, that faith is a passionate commitment made in objective uncertainty. And you say, however, that biblical Protestantism undermines that.
Well, by that expression, biblical Protestantism, I mean that sort of fundamentalism which says we are Bible-based, i.e. there are some doctrines which you have to accept. I remember somebody invited me out for a meal, and I was the chaplain of a college, and it was a member of the college. He said, do you believe in substitutionary atonement? So I said, do you mean Anselm or somebody else? And he said, I don't think we'll be coming to chapel. You know, I wasn't giving the right answer. I should have said yes. And that's what I mean. You say, who now knows what substitutionary atonement is? It's a 16th century Calvin doctrine. But you don't have to believe that. It doesn't say substitutionary atonement in the Bible.
But how do people then live with that uncertainty?
I know, that's what they feel, that's the trouble. I think it's very sad if they have to have certainty where you can't get any certainty. They're going to have to deceive themselves and pretend they have certainty, because there isn't any. You know, any two religious people who meet are going to disagree sooner or later. Disagreement's a part of the vitality of a living faith. The secret is to learn to disagree without hating and say, actually, I rather like disagreement. Of course, I'm a professional philosopher. I've taught philosophy for years, so I've got that personality which likes disagreement, can have a good argument, but in friendship. But I think that's part of religion, because it is objectively uncertain. I mean, I say there's a God. I am personally certain there's a God, but I'm not theoretically certain, because if I was, I could prove it to you. You know, if I was absolutely certain, there'd be no doubt. You'd be insane if you didn't believe it, and that's not true.
But of course, many believers find themselves in encounters with atheists or secularists who say, prove it to me. And yes. and they feel they must. They must point to something, because otherwise they are seen as fools who believe in something they are not certain of.
Yeah. I think that's an unfortunate feature of our culture at the moment in Britain and Europe. But I think people who say that, if they're scientists, they need to think of how many uncertain things there are in science. And they need to think of things like the fact that one of the greatest physicists of all time, Albert Einstein, spent the last years of his life trying to disprove quantum theory. He was wrong. He was absolutely wrong. But it was great that he tried. You wouldn't say what a fool he was to believe all this rubbish. You'd say that was a great effort that he made and well done. But he just happened to be wrong. But in science, there are all these disputes going on all the time, and any good scientist will disagree with other scientists. You think they don't disagree. You think they all accept the truth. Of course they don't. You go into a physics laboratory, and they're all disagreeing with each other, and they're all rooting in faith for their own theory. Passionate commitment, but not objective certainty. Any good scientist will admit that. And if they don't admit that, they're not a good scientist.
Well, I think it's fair to say you are a very good writer on religion, on theology, on religion and science. You've written 35 books. Is it fair to say that you, yourself, Keith Ward, has shifted thinking about faith in God in today's world?
Well, I mean, since that conversion experience that you refer to, I think I would betray myself if I ever went back on thinking that I had encountered God in the person of Jesus Christ. So that is a basic aspect of my personality now. But certainly I've shifted in lots of particular ways and particular questions about how you understand exactly things.
But have you shifted the thinking of other Christians? That's what I'm after.
Ah, well, I wouldn't know that.
Is that really true that you wouldn't know that? I mean, you've been around long enough. You've been writing these books. You've been meeting with parishioners and other people, scholars and clergy.
Well, on a personal level, in small ways, yes, I have had an influence on people's thoughts. But in the wider context, there are actually lots of people who think like me, so I'm not alone. There are lots of us, really. And it's hard for us to tell what influence we have. How do you measure it? You know, we take a survey and things like that. So I think I've done what I was able to do, and I'm leaving that to Providence, whatever it is.
Probably very wise, but let me ask you one last question. The Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby, he's an interesting person who seems to straddle a number of different religious forms, Benedictine spirituality, evangelical faith, etc. Do you think that he perhaps exemplifies this more open acceptance that there are many routes to God, even within the Christian faith itself?
Yes, I think the Archbishop has not said exactly what he thinks on lots of these problems. Very wise of him not to do so. But he is a card-carrying evangelical, committed to basic belief in the revelation of God in the Bible, and in that, I don't disagree with that phrase, but he does, as you rightly say, show an openness to many sorts of approaches in religion. And so, as far as I can tell, he does represent a new face of evangelicalism within the Church of England, which is unfortunately not worldwide exactly, but I hope it will become. And that is an open evangelicalism, where you say we are evangelicals, but we do not dissociate ourselves from people who have a more liberal attitude or a more Catholic approach or a more ritual approach, perhaps, to the faith. And yeah, I think that's a good way to go.
Perhaps I should ask you finally, where would you put yourself in the Anglican Church today?
That's a very good question. I'm very happy in the Anglican Church. If I was pressed, I would describe myself as liberal Catholic. I have to be a liberal somewhere just to signify that I'm not committed to any one strict interpretation of the Bible. So I put liberal in to signify that. Catholic or evangelical, I like pretty clothes and incense, but, you know, that's a matter of taste. So I'm happy just to say, with John Calvin, actually, I don't like his theology, but he did say the church exists wherever people believe that Christ unites human beings to God and where the sacraments are celebrated. So I put myself anywhere, so I could go to almost any church, really.
Well, I think that fits very well, your whole treatise on the rethinking of Christian faith, that it should be more open. It's been a complete delight talking to you. Thank you so much for being on The Spirit of Things.
Well, thank you, Rachel.